Good morning. Will you please stand as you're able and join in our responsive call to worship? Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed is the church that serves with the love of God to eradicate systematic poverty." Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. And blessed is the church that trusts in the grace of Christ to build congregational vitality." Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God." And blessed is the church that seeks by the power of the Spirit to dismantle structural racism. Blessed are you, O holy triune God, and blessed is your holy realm forever. Let us worship and work together. Our call to confession. A voice is crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord." Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sins as individuals, as a community, as a church, praying together. Merciful God, we confess that we have wandered from the way of truth and life. You call us to share all that we have and work together for the common good. We can purchase treasures for ourselves and deny others their daily bread. You call us to set the captives free and seek justice for the oppressed. But we live in fear of our neighbors and hide ourselves from our own kin. You call us to walk in newness of life and witnesses to the resurrection, but we dwell in the valley of dry bones, and keep silent about your saving love. Forgive us, God of grace. Set us free from sin, death, and fear, so that we may serve with gladness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Traveling these wide roads for so long, my heart's been far from you. 10,000 miles gone, I want to come near and give you every part of me. There's blood on my hands and my lips are unclean. In my darkness, I remember Mama's words reoccur to me. Surrender to the good Lord, and He'll wipe your slate clean. Take me to your river. Me in your smooth waters I go in. As a man with many cries, come up for air as my sins flow down the Jordan. I want to come near and give every part of me, but there's blood on my hands and my lips are unclean. Take me to your river, I want to go. Oh, take me to your river, I want to know. I want to go, want to go.
Words of assurance. Sisters and brothers, and all members of the family of God, nothing you have done, nothing you will ever do is enough to separate you from the one who loved you into existence and who will love you past death. In Jesus' name, I declare that our sin is forgiven. We begin again. Amen. I thought Peter was going to read the scripture. We'll punt. So first, many thanks to Sean Townley, who
just sang a beautiful song, is running the tech back there, and is also the elder commissioner from New Hope, all at the same time in this service today and for our meeting. So many thanks for that. So here are these words from the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 37. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all round them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you and will cause flesh to come upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you. And you shall live and you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. And then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live.'" For the word of God in scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God. So I know that Halloween has passed and people have already started putting up their Christmas trees, but here we are with a story that kind of feels a little bit like a horror film scene. We have Ezekiel, our prophet, who is great for us visual learners, who is taken to a valley of dry bones. So many, no longer connected, just scattered all around. And then this valley becomes the scene for a dramatic restoration of life. Scattered bones are rejoined, and muscle and flesh cover them to form bodies. And God gives them breath or spirit, depending on how you want to translate the Hebrew, and they live. It is an extraordinary vision. But I want to go back to these dry bones first. Because like many of the prophets, Ezekiel is writing to the Israelites in a time of exile. After the excitement of arriving in the promised land following years of wandering in the wilderness, the nation of Israel has suffered from political corruption and division and war. And now the Babylonians have conquered them, and much of the Israelites are in exile, removed from their roots and the place that has given them identity. Ezekiel offers this dramatic vision of the valley of dry bones. And just in case we would miss the metaphor, we're told pretty clearly, God says, "Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely." We have all probably known seasons of exile in our own lives. Times when we too felt dried up, cut off from our sources of comfort or identity, hopeless. It's hard in those moments to imagine what new life can look like. And in each of our own ways, we all collectively experienced a kind of exile during the peak of the pandemic. And our churches felt that, not being able to gather the way that we were used to for a while, maybe missing singing or eating together, perhaps sharing fewer hugs with the hope of sharing fewer germs. And during these past few years, we've also experienced as a nation a groundswell of protests for racial justice, toxic political rhetoric that has spilled into actual violence, rising prices that particularly hurt the poorest among us who are already struggling. It has been a hard, weird season for us as individuals, in our churches, in our nation, and in our world. And even now, when most of us are probably back to our usual routines, so many of us carry the ripples of grief from that season. People we have lost, opportunities that we missed, relationships that have changed. And so we may have the same question that is asked of Ezekiel. Can these bones live? When we grapple with the stain of racism in our communities, and yes, in our churches, when we recognize patterns that are not lifting up the whole of the body of Christ, when we struggle to move from merely naming the problem to seeking transformation, we wonder, can these bones live? When we see our neighbors struggling to make ends meet in a nation with so much wealth, having to decide between paying rent or buying groceries, when that job opportunity doesn't pay enough to account for the gas needed for the commute, when people are hurting without access to affordable health care or buried in debt because of the care they did receive, we wonder, can these bones live? When we sometimes find ourselves just going through the motions in our churches, but we can't shake the shadows of anxiety and grief that rest below the surface. When people are tired, communities are divided, pastors are stretched thin, we wonder, can these bones live? It's important to note that the question about these dry bones returning to life does not come from Ezekiel, but it comes from God. Ezekiel is faced with this hopeless scene of loss and destruction, perhaps the scene of a great battle or some other great tragedy. And I would imagine he sees no hope in that landscape. But it is God who asks him to see the possibilities and asks, can these bones live? If we're honest, most of us might respond with a resounding, nope, probably not. But Ezekiel had a different response. He might not have been able to imagine the new life that God was asking him to consider, but he knew who could. Because Ezekiel's response is an affirmation in the faith of the God who surpasses our limited understanding when he says, "Oh, Lord God, you know." My friend Marcy Glass once wrote about this part of the text and said that Ezekiel's reply makes it clear that God's imagination is better than ours. God can imagine life where we can only see death. God can imagine solutions where we see wreckage. God can still cry out in a loud voice, creating life, creating justice when we fall mute before the desolation. As ministers and elders in the Presbyterian Church, we take vows when we are ordained and commissioned for service, as Carl and PK will be at the end of our meeting today. And one of my favorites is the promise to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love. I even got the t-shirt for it. Sometimes I think the imagination part of our call gets the most neglected. We are called to lead with imagination, to see the potential for a hopeful future that maybe only God can imagine at this moment. But we are called to lead with that imagination. It's why Ezekiel doesn't just have a theoretical conversation with God about the potential of the dry bones. He's given a call to speak hope into those dry bones. And God continues to call us to do the same. Last year, we made the decision to become a Matthew 25 Presbytery. And that involves commitments to three areas of the Matthew 25 initiative within our denomination: eradicating systemic poverty, dismantling structural racism, and building congregational vitality. And they are all interconnected, which makes the work all the more important and complicated. And they are a part of that challenge to speak hope and to work to bring new life to the dry bones of our communities and our world. We Presbyterians love to joke about being the frozen chosen, but that is not who we are, and that is not who we are called to be. What if we employed some energy and intelligence and imagination and love and thought of ourselves not as the frozen chosen, but maybe as the thawed and called instead? I know it doesn't rhyme unless you say it with a really thick Southern drawl that I don't have, but it almost gets there. But let's live into the truth of what the Spirit could do through us, because these dry bones can live. Exciting things are happening in our churches and in our presbytery, some of which you will hear about in this meeting. We're finding new ways to be the church. We found creative possibilities for connections through online worship and working through the kinks of online hybrid presbytery meetings. We'll be using technology to help us share in Bible study together across the presbytery in the new year. We have a racial justice task force that has been working together to take seriously how we grapple with our systems that do not allow all of our siblings to thrive. We're looking at how we can creatively use the resources of this presbytery to help break cycles of poverty in people's lives. We are continuing to nurture the lives and faith of children and youth and young adults through our camp and campus ministries. These bones can live. Energy, intelligence, imagination, and love. We have the tools that we need to help our communities thrive. And we have what we need to help break out of any systems that deny the life-giving and liberating work of the gospel that we are called to bear into the world. We are just 12 short days away from the beginning of Advent, when we are invited once again to put our holy imaginations to work as we proclaim our hope in new life in the form of an unexpected Savior. When we proclaim that Christ came into the midst of our lives to stir us awake, to proclaim good news to those on the margins, to restore justice in our fractured lives, to turn the world right side up, and to show what God's love looks like in action. These dry bones can indeed live. Hope persists. So let us get to work. Amen.
I know we had a few prayer requests this morning that Laura sent me that were from online, but I was going to ask if there are any other prayer requests that we have to lift up this morning. All right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the University of Virginia. Of Idaho. Okay. Let's go to God now in prayer. Lord, we come before you this morning. In the quiet, we can hear the rain hitting the roof. It's one of those days where we want to just curl back up in bed and read a book or sleep, but not really engage in the world. We look at all the things that are going on around us. Every day we hear more about natural disasters, war, people freezing, people hungry, school shootings, others who are struggling in various ways, and the continued ravaging of the pandemic. So often as we wake up, just as we do on rainy mornings, we might look out at the world and see it would just be easier to roll over and pull the covers back up. But Lord, you do call us. You call us to look upon all that is around us and not to minimize the pain, but to recognize that there is hope. To understand that you can see those things that we cannot see, that you have that godly imagination that spoke our world into being. That we can trust in you as we work together to bring about the change that you have called us to participate in. We are called to be a people of hope. We are called to be a people who look at things in a different way. Lord, we ask that you would continue to bless us, that you would be with all those throughout our world who are struggling, whether it's from natural disaster or from war, domestic violence, addiction, those who are recovering from surgery, those who have lost loved ones and mourn. We pray especially for the University of Idaho and the University of Virginia, as they are the most recent communities to have to deal with shootings. We pray for Jacqueline and her family as they prepare to go to Nashville for the birth of their baby, who will require heart surgery soon. We pray for them as they are in Nashville for 2 months, that they would find the care and the support that they would need, that they would continue to feel your loving arms around them and know that they are loved. We thank you for the successful surgery of Bert Pyatt this morning and for the others in the New Hope congregation that are recovering from surgery. And for others throughout our presbytery who are struggling with health issues. We thank you for technology. And we pray that we will be able to use it wisely, and that it will continue to help us reach more people. And Lord, do let us not just be hopeful during this time of Advent, but to remember that we are a people of hope all year. And that to do that, we need to be thawed and called and to respond. We pray now the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please rise in body or spirit as you are able as we sing our closing hymn. Friends, now that our service has ended, our service as a presbytery truly begins. So let us do this work together this day and in our communities far beyond today with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love, trusting that we do not do this work alone, for we are surrounded with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the community of the Holy Spirit, who surrounds us and sustains us now and always. Amen. Please be seated. Roberts and to Larissa Abrahamian for providing us with music this morning, especially Pat, because she's not a member. She's a member of the Chattanooga Community Orchestra that practices here on Mondays. And so she offered some of her time for us this morning. So thank you.
All right, friends. Well, let us continue with our business of the day. Moving now to the consent agenda that you have before you in the packet. Does anyone have anything to remove from the consent agenda before we proceed? Emily, yes. Can you specify? Okay, so we will move that to under the coordinating committee report. Thank you. Any other? All right, so with the exception of moving that piece, that first motion off of the consent agenda, we are ready to approve that as at this time. So with that change, we don't need to vote on this one. So by consent, we will approve that with that exception of moving that one item off. And that actually moves us now to the coordinating committee report, which I believe is Karen joining us on Zoom.
All right. Yes.
We know if we will be able to hear Karen. Karen, did you get that note of what that we just moved that first motion off and you now have that piece to cover in your report?
Okay. The first motion about the executive director.
We are not hearing you yet, Karen. So hang on just a second.
Can you hear me now?
Okay, we can see you. Maybe try to talk and we'll see if we can hear you.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, we might need to turn you up a little bit, but we can hear you.
Okay.
Okay, Karen, if you can hear me, go ahead and proceed with your report.
All right. So the first motion that has been taken out of the consent agenda is that the executive director of John Knox Center, Bree Payne, receive a pay increase of $6,334. As recommended by the outdoor ministry team and the coordinating committee.
Okay, thank you. That is our first motion. I will try to not. Yeah. Okay, is there any discussion on the motion? It's under the coordinating committee report now. We can, if we would rather do that first. I just moved it to the first thing on the coordinating committee report. Okay. Yes, please, if you'll come to one of these.
Mostly what I have are a lot of questions, and I'm sorry, Emily Anderson, New Providence, teaching elder. I have a lot of questions that mostly have to do with the John Knox budget. I'm wondering where this increase is coming from, because it's not a standard 5% like our other staff are getting. And I'm also curious about, I requested the balance sheet information, and well, maybe somebody can first tell me about the background on this increase.
Okay. Karen, can you speak to that from coordinating committee?
Well, I believe that it is close to 5%, and it's what the outdoor ministry team recommended.
Hearing you.
You can't hear me? is Roy Scarborough here? He would know where that amount came from.
It's not here.
And Josh, I know Josh McGill is here. He could probably speak to it as well.
Are you there on Zoom?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So the request came from Outdoor Ministries team. The original plan in the fall of 2021, OMT did, or they performed some, I guess, market ranges for Bree's position and for Ryan Hughes, who's the program director, along with Bree, who's the executive director. And they found that the positions they felt like were underpaid for peer comparisons for other types of campus ministry related to camps. And so to try to bring those compensation packages closer to market, OMT wanted to do a 2-year increase instead of, they wanted to do basically a $10,000 increase for each employee. So last fall, as part of the 2022 budget, OMT brought a recommendation to basically increase each position by $5,000. That was approved. And so that went into effect for calendar year 22. So this request is a follow-up on that to bridge the gap, what OMT feels like is depressed salaries or compensation packages for the staff, and get them closer in line with market ranges. As far as how has OMT performed that search, I will need to revert to OMT as they perform that analysis.
And nobody's here.
And is there anyone from OMT who is here?
Madam Moderator, I'm Bree Payne, the Executive Director at John Knox Center. One of the ways they did this is in the summer of 2021, Nokomi, the Presbytery's camp that is directly west of us in Tennessee, was hiring a program director, and that program director starting salary was $36,000. Our program director's salary at that time was $23,500. And so that began the discussion of different positions and looking at other camps that are similar to us in Kentucky and in Georgia, the presbyteries that are directly close to us. Holston is another one that they looked at. They're similar housing compensation packages as well as salary compensation. It also looked like John Knox Center was about $10,000 on average below these other Presbytery camp staff that are directly beside us. The other problem is salary compression, where, as you know, in the last 3 years, we have had to increase the salaries needed of our summer staff, of our housekeeping staff, of our kitchen staff and janitorial staff. That causes an issue when you get to the fact that I could potentially have a summer camp counselor who could make very close to what I do in a summer. We're talking a 19-year-old college student. We absolutely believe they need to be making more than what they were making in 2020 or 2019, which was $185 a week. We think that was low. So we have increased that twice over the past 2 years. So that salary compression was also part of the discussion as well. As we increase hourly staff, weekly staff, we also need to look at our full-time staff to make sure that we are even with what the market value is to presbyteries that have similar programs with similar staff directly related to us.
Okay, thanks.
I guess my next question is, why are we voting only on the executive director's package and not the program director's package?
Because the program director is considered part of John Knox Center staff, which is included in the overall budget for John Knox Center. Because my position is hired by the Presbytery, it means that any salary or contractual change to my package has to come to the floor, unlike a counselor or a program director who's included in the budget no matter what.
Okay, thank you. And then this is the other question, the bigger question that I have and why I pulled this item off is this is coming out of the Presbytery's budget. I get that. I get it that Bree is a Presbytery employee, but I'm also looking at John Knox Center's retained earnings, which they're sitting on $158,000 right now. That's more than we give them for an entire year. And I guess I want to hear something from OMT about what that money is designed for. It just sits there and keeps accumulating and accumulating. And I just need some information about why we're doing that.
So part of the retained earnings currently is going to go to cover the floor, that is the dining hall floor that is right now being repolished in the dining hall, as well as the pavilion bathrooms that we have desperately been trying to build for the last 3 years, but because of inflation and other things like that, and because we've had trouble getting a construction company to actually come to Rome County in the middle of nowhere and work, the last quote that we got was $243,000 for a 12 by 20 building. We felt like that was not good stewardship of our funds, whether or not we had that money to use it for that with that particular quote. So we have been on hold working to try to find another company that can do that. I would turn to you and ask your churches what kind of retained earnings, or maybe another word to say is a savings account, that your churches have to build new buildings, buy new vehicles, replace air conditioner units. That's what some of those funds will go toward. As far as that particular salary increase, it is included in our 2023 budget that will be both from donations, but as well as from campers who come to camp, environmental ed students, guest groups, et cetera.
Okay, and we do have another someone on Zoom who has a question, but maybe Josh, if you can. Okay, Josh, if you can clarify for us, and maybe this is getting at your question, Emily, if that Presbytery has to approve this amount because of the nature of the position and what Presbytery has to approve, but is this changing the budget for the Presbytery from what we are about to discuss? Yeah.
The amount proposed for Breeze does not change Presbytery's allocation in the Presbytery budget to John Knox. It does not change that amount. What it does change is Breeze, if you want to call it per se, terms of call or employment agreement with Presbytery. They're independent of each other.
Bethany Benz Whittington is on Zoom and has a question. Bethany, if you can hear me, hang on 1 second. Wait, we cannot hear you yet. We will get there.
Well, my microphone's on. Can you hear me? Okay. Josh said just a moment ago, thank you, Matthew, that this had been approved over a two-year period already. So I'm curious about that it was going to be a raise done over 2 years that has been approved by the Presbytery already. So is this the second half of that? And if so, do we have to approve it again? And then also, what will Bree's compensation be, and is it close even to Presbytery minimums?
Josh,
Laura, I'll take that. Laura, I'll take that one. So Bethany, I think that there was maybe a miscommunication or slight misunderstanding there. When OMT performed the salary assessment in 2021, they, instead of doing a one-year lump sum, just to keep the numbers nice and simple, of $10,000 a piece for Bree and Ryan, they wanted it to break it over 2 years. So what they said is, we will only bring, for calendar year 2022 budget, we only want to bring a $5,000 increase. And then the plan, and so then that was approved. At that time, they said that they would bring the request for an additional $5,000 back. And that's what is on the floor now, for the intent for that to go in 2023. So the question is, has this particular item been previously approved? It has not. Only the first $5,000 that went into effect for calendar year 2022 has been approved. This will go into effect, if approved, starting in 2023.
Josh, if you can speak to this part of that, to the second part of that question that Bethany had about where that puts Bree's salary in terms of Presbytery minimum.
Give me about 20 seconds. Do you know what the Presbytery minimums are, Laura?
That under COM. Appendix B, thank you. It is 34,949 is what we are about to consider.
Can you say that amount again?
34,949 is the salary minimum for 2023.
Yes, this will be above that.
Bree is not a minister, and therefore correct. The salary
minimums
don't hold.
Correct. But if Bethany was just asking for contrast, but yes, thank you. Any other questions or discussion of the motion?
I have one more thing.
Okay, thank you.
Again, back to the $158,000 in retained earnings. And Bree, maybe this is for you to take back to your committee. As a member of Presbytery, I love and support John Knox. I want to see it succeed. But right before the pandemic, we forgave $250,000 loan to John Knox when there was $110,000 in retained earnings. It feels to me, and this could be wrong, it feels like the Presbytery keeps giving and giving and giving to John Knox, and we're not getting the details of where our money is going. So I just would ask for you and for your committee that we start getting more reports to Presbytery instead of, I know kids have fun at summer camp. Good for them, good for you, that's wonderful. But we need some more financial accountability coming from OMT to the Presbytery, I think. Or some more reporting, at least, of where the money's going.
Okay, thank you. Other questions, Loudon?
Yeah, sorry, this is more for OMT, not directly for you, Bree. But
Who are you?
Sorry, I'm Loudon. I'm one of the associate pastors at New Providence. But just a question on, this looks like it was deferred maintenance over a sustained period of time. Has OMT addressed how they will do that moving forward, so it's not another chunk of time and then they come back for a bigger chunk, rather than looking at systemically as a year by year, how are we looking at keeping that position marketable, or all staff positions marketable?
Yes, absolutely, and you are correct. My position did not receive any type of salary increase or change from 2008 until 2015, none. While the rest of the Presbytery staff received 3% or 5% changes, this particular position, because it is embedded in the John Knox Center budget, so not directly related really to the Presbytery budget, did not receive those same changes. So between 2008 and 2015, there was zero change in this position. Then there was a 3% in 2015, and then there was no other change until 2021. So yes, going forward, OMT is working with personnel to make these changes more uniform across the board, whereas not just having to play catch up from the previous decade that nothing was done.
Okay, thank you. All right, not seeing anyone rise for questions or discussion. Anyone on Zoom that I may have missed? who may have a question. All right, are we ready to vote? So the motion before us is that the executive director of John Knox receive a pay increase of $6,334 as recommended by the outdoor ministry team and the coordinating committee. If we can get the poll up for those who are voting online, you will see that momentarily. Let me wait till they get that up and can start voting. Are we ready to vote? Folks here? Okay. Okay, for those attending in person, all those in favor of the motion say yes.
Yes.
Any opposed say no. Okay, those who are joining on Zoom, you should have a poll shortly, I hope, to vote. God bless all of our technology and everyone who's helping work on it. Are they voting, James? Okay, that's all right. This will be good. We say, you know, we need our vows of energy, intelligence, imagination, and love, and humor and patience are probably some that would be important for us to cultivate as well. And we appreciate all of them.
Madam Moderator, I have a suggestion.
So hopefully there will be a poll arriving soon. Karen, are you needing to speak?
I was just going to say that those on Zoom, if you go to reactions and do a thumbs up, if you're for it, we could do it that way.
I'm not able to see all the screens. So let's hold off on that.
Okay.
I know he's totally bored back there, not doing anything. Anybody have a song they want to sing? We could do a camp song. John Farone, you can lead us in a song. Okay, fair enough. We could walk the labyrinth. That would be lovely. By the time we get to the center, we will have found the poll with which our Zoom attendees can vote. Maybe turn to someone next to you and tell them something you are grateful for today. For real, you gotta talk to each other. Introduce yourself if you don't know who you're sitting with. Tell them something you're grateful for today.
Got it.
Okay. Okay, an important instruction for folks who are on Zoom. We are having trouble getting the poll with the wording of the motion to appear. So what you do have is a poll from the consent agenda. You are not voting on the consent agenda. You are voting on the motion that the executive director of John Knox Center, Bree Payne, receive a pay increase of $6,334 as recommended by the outdoor ministry team and the coordinating committee. So if you are on Zoom, you would like to vote in favor of that motion, choose yes. If you would like to not vote in favor of that motion, choose no. And please vote at this time. Okay, the motion passes. Thank you all. All right, Karen, you have one more motion.
That's right.
And we will wait just one quick moment till we can make sure you can be heard.
All right, can you hear me now? Yes? Okay. So my motion is from the coordinating committee is that the proposed Presbytery budget for 2023 be approved, and you can find that in Appendix A.
All right, thank you, Karen. Any discussion or questions on the motion? Grady.
My name is Grady Parsons. I'm an honorary retired minister and slave away at Westminster Presbyterian Church as a parish associate. I have a motion to make because things aren't complicated enough.
I appreciate that.
And if I get a second, I'll speak to it. I move that the 2023 Presbytery budget be referred back to the coordinating committee with instructions to find additional funds for campus ministries and bring the 2023 budget back to Presbytery at its February meeting for approval. I so move.
All right, so there's already a second. All right, you may speak to that more.
I appreciate all the work that goes into putting together a budget. I've put together some institutional budgets of my own that are pretty complicated. But I'm concerned that we're asking two of our members to absorb all of the inflation, all of the raises in salary, in Presbytery salary minimums, all of the other impacts with really a decrease in funding from us. I realize part of this was a negotiation previously. But under those previous negotiations, we didn't have 8% inflation and a 5% salary increase for ministers. So all I'm asking is that the coordinating committee with whoever else needs to be there, take a second look. I realize the amounts in the budget are what campus ministries ask for, but I think a further conversation in light of the information we have now about cost might give different answers. So I'm just asking that we have a new conversation about the budget and bring it back in February so we can make a more intelligent decision.
Okay, so we have a motion to refer this budget back to the coordinating committee, particularly with an eye toward campus ministries of how inflation might need to be factored into that differently. Does anybody else want to speak to that motion? Anyone on Zoom that would like to speak to that motion or ask any questions?
Laura, I have a question. It's Josh McGill.
Okay. All right, Josh, go ahead.
Question for Grady. I know you specifically called out campus ministries. Are there any other committees within the budget that you would like for us to examine as part of those conversations or simply target the campus ministries?
Target the campus ministries in a good way.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, I just didn't know if you wanted us to go back and redo the process with all the committees of the Presbytery or just focus on the campus ministries. So, okay. Thanks, Grady.
One of the things, if we are reconsidering, if that is something that is being done, I believe there was a miscommunication between the youth committee, EQIP, and coordinating council on the amount that was requested from youth, which you all see is at $5,000. We communicated that we wanted to renew our request for the full amount that we had been asking for at the 2019 level, which was $10,000. The reason we have only taken five the last 2 years was because we as a ministry were better suited with our reserve accounts to take on out of our reserves to maintain the ministry than our colleagues in EQIP were able to from their ministries. Our actual cost for 2021 were significantly lower. Our costs for this year to do the ministry we have done in 2022 are a little over $12,000. Which we can continue to support from reserves that we do have, which are about $28,000 in reserves in our accounts, but that is not a sustainable model, which means at some point we may have to make drastic cuts unless it's addressed in other budgets to our youth ministry. And this does not include triennium in 2025, which will be additional expenses.
Okay.
Thank you.
So thank you for that. So the motion on the floor is to refer this to back to the coordinating committee to bring perhaps an amended budget to the February meeting if there are, with the attention to campus ministry, if there are other variables that need to be considered by coordinating committee, that needs to get communicated to the coordinating committee as well. So thank you for that.
Is that intended as an amendment to the motion that is currently on the floor, or is that something that coordinating committee can take up?
I did not hear that as an amendment, so I am taking that as information while the budget is being reevaluated. Right. Let's hold that. If we do not, if we defeat the motion to refer it, then you can make an amendment to the budget. Yes.
Charles White, ruling elder, Second Presbyterian Knoxville. Parliamentary question. Is it practice or canon that a budget cannot be amended after the budget's been put in place? I know in several instances that is common practice in many associations. I ask this question because would it not make more sense to approve the budget so that we have a budget in place and let the committee look at the increase that's needed and bring it back to amend the budget at a later time? Thank you.
Okay, we have amended, we have voted to amend the budget before. We did that at our August Presbytery meeting. So that has been a practice, to answer your question.
Bylaws.
Nothing prohibiting that in the bylaws. So were you making an alternative motion, or just that clarification is helpful for you to have as you vote?
Not making it as a motion, but I am, with due respect, Craig, speaking against his motion.
Okay.
And then after that vote, possibly making a motion.
Thank you for clarifying that. Any other discussion on the motion to refer? Anybody on Zoom? Okay, Clay.
Clay Thomas, Minister, Rivermont Presbyterian Church. What is the projected revenue for 2023? I don't see that on the budget. And the 2021 and 2022 actuals were significantly higher than 620. I think that might be helpful. It'd be a lot easier to amend if it's higher than the expense.
Josh, are you able to speak to that for projected revenues for 2023?
Laura, the stewardship letters from finance are in the works of being drafted and sent out to the congregations. Obviously, a lot of congregations have not made their own respective budgets to date. So we kind of look at it from a historical perspective. I would anticipate revenue to land somewhere between 530 and 550. It's kind of a gambling game. So that we typically side. When we build the budget, we typically look at historical, and then we'll basically use prior year activity to kind of use a roll forward and estimate what activities are going to, what we think will hold, as long as there's no material changes within the churches that we know of. And that we just kind of hold that steady, but we can evaluate that further.
Thank you. Any other questions or discussion? Questions or discussion on the motion? All right, are we ready to vote? Jacqueline, are we ready to vote with a poll for those on Zoom?
Yes,
I believe we are. Okay, I believe we have a poll ready. All right, so all those in favor of the motion to refer the budget back to the coordinating committee to make adjustments, particularly with an eye toward campus ministries, to bring that back to the February Presbytery meeting for a vote. All in favor of the motion say yes.
Yes.
Any opposed say no.
No.
Let's get the Zoom vote. The poll. All right, another opportunity to prepare. Y'all are making my last meeting to moderate exciting. Right, we are hoping and praying for the technology to do what it needs to do. Now take a moment, turn to someone else near you that you didn't talk to a second ago, and introduce yourself if you don't know them, and share the most interesting movie or TV show you have seen recently. All right, those who are voting on Zoom, you have your poll up and you're ready to vote. And now we know why we couldn't get it to work. So we are gonna just truck on through. So go ahead and vote if you are on Zoom.
Moderator, the results are 29 out of 35 yes, 6 out of 35 no.
Okay, so the yeses have it. So the motion passes to refer this back to the coordinating committee. Okay, I'm glad to do that for those who are here. So we'll just do a show of hands. All those in favor of the motion so we can get a count, say yes. I mean, not say yes, raise your hand. If somebody wants to double count with me to make sure, that would be great. I got 39. Okay. If your vote is no, please raise your hand. I got 12. Okay, so the yeses have it. Thank you. All right, Karen, got anything else from the coordinating committee?
Well, everything else, no, I don't. Everything else has been approved by the consent agenda.
Again, Karen, please.
There is nothing else.
Thank you, Karen. All right, we are ready for the Committee on Preparation for Ministry report. Is Susan Reisinger here or is Susan online? Okay, Susan, we will tell you in a second when we've got you ready to talk. They're doing a little shuffle up here with the computers. Okay. Do you have something to say to? Do you say it in front of the whole class? Okay.
Moderator, I believe we need to approve to carry over the 2022 budget so that we can pay people in January because we're not going to meet again before the new calendar year. So right now we won't have a budget. Is that correct? Clay Thomas, Vermont First Junior.
Until there's another budget.
By de facto. Daniel's.
Thank you for making sure we pay all of our people in our ministries, though. It was passed in 2022. I think. All right. You all tell me when we're ready for the CPM report. Okay, Susan, we think we are ready for your report.
Hello, can you hear me? Yeah, excellent. The Committee on Preparation has one motion, and it is an amendment to our handbook, which by what it says in our handbook requires a 3/4 vote of the committee, which we've had, and a majority vote of the presbytery. We want to change one sentence in the handbook that would include the underlining got lost in the motion. What's underlined, what's new is the last phrase from the semicolon on, unless the candidate develops an alternative. And we want to add that to give us more flexibility, especially with those people who are second career, going through seminary at the same time as they're holding down a job, as CPE has become more and more of a challenge, clinical pastoral education. You see the background information that we gave, but I can answer any questions, I hope, that you might have. So I put
Thank
that
you. Motion. Thank you, we have the motion. Oh wait, did you say need to say something else?
I was just gonna put the motion before the body.
Thank you. So we have this motion before us. Is there any discussion? Seeing no one rise here, anyone on Zoom have a question or statement? All right, I think we are ready to vote if the poll is ready to go. All those in favor, are y'all ready for me to go ahead and call the vote? All right, all those in favor of the motion say yes or vote yes on the poll. Any opposed say no. Right, folks are voting online.
On Zoom, we're recording 34 yes, 0 no.
All right, the motion passes. Thank you. Anything else from CPM?
That concludes my report. Thank you all.
I think you said no.
I did say no. No more.
To make sure. Thank you. All right, John Thomason from Property and Loan Committee. We've got a live person presenting a report here in the room. It's up to you. Actually, you're closer to a mic down here. Let's do the mic here. We'll save you some steps.
Is it still morning?
Almost not.
Good morning. I'm John Thomason. I'm a ruling elder at Farragut Presbyterian Church. I have the privilege of serving as chair of the property committee, also a member of the Spring Place Administrative Commission. We're working through issues with Spring Place. They have decided to close their doors, close out their business decently and in order, and they're doing it themselves with the help of the property committee, Spring Place Administrative Commission, and a really good attorney. So far, we've separated the church property from the cemetery. The church property is a tiny piece of property with an old building on it. Cemetery is much larger. Two separate deeds. The church property and its built the building and everything has been sold. That transaction should conclude mid-December. Church wants to close December 31st. The new owner of the property is hoping to be the new owner of the property and meet as the owners of the property in the building the first time, January 1st. I'm going to read two motions place them on the floor. These motions will allow the cemetery property to be transferred to the presbytery. It'll allow the trustees that are currently in place, still the trustees of the church, to give their cemetery to the presbytery. It'll also allow them to sign documents with banks that will transfer, retitle the assets that make up the cemetery fund to the name of the presbytery. They want to do that themselves before they end their ministry, which began in 1842. So I'm going to read both motions. We'll see if we have any discussion. We can vote on them together, maybe. Grant Spring Place Presbyterian Church of Knoxville authority to convey its cemetery property to the presbytery with the monies designated by the church as cemetery funds to also be transferred to the presbytery when the deed from the church to the presbytery is signed. These actions have been previously approved by the Spring Place session and congregation. The second motion grants Spring Place Presbyterian Church of Knoxville authority to dissolve on December 31st of this year, with the presbytery to hold a worship service recognizing the life and history of the church, which was founded in 1842. This action has already been approved by the Spring Place session and congregation. Reverend Wynn Bryant served that church for several years. He is the kind of the architect of all that's taken place in the sale of the church property to the church that's taken it over. And he plans to make that presentation at the February Presbytery. He was going to do it today, but duty calls. I think his own church had other plans for him today.
All right. Any discussion on the motion?
Madam Moderator, Tim Reynolds, teaching elder at Second Pres Knoxville. I have a question, and that is, has this cemetery been designated as closed by the state of Tennessee?
I don't know.
No, it's a live, open cemetery.
So follow-up question, this means that it is still a functioning cemetery where people are being buried?
Yes.
Then I would urge that we vote no on taking this over from the congregation. That's a lot of work for a presbytery that we don't really have the expertise to do.
Thank you.
Can I answer that question? Or
sorry, do you want to speak to that? Sure.
On January 1st, the presbytery will own this cemetery, whether we want it or not. It'll be a whole lot easier to transfer the deed while we still have the trustees and the congregation that exists than if we wait until after January 1st. There's no organization to transfer it. It'll be in limbo, and we'll get more attorney fees to straighten it out. But if you look at the Book of Order, we own the cemetery whether we want it or not. But I share your sentiments. It's not a job that we really want to do.
Okay, I hear there's a question on Zoom.
Yeah. Can you hear me? Cool. My church also has a cemetery, and so we have a board of trustees, a board that runs the cemetery separately from the church. Is there, as we're discussing this, a plan in place to do something like that at the presbytery level? Since either way, we're taking over this plot of land, will we be putting in place some mechanism for managing it?
We have a plan to develop a plan. Yes.
Okay. Any other discussion? Sure. We can share.
Carl McDonald, ruling elder, New Providence. I chair the administrative commission for Spring Place. that you all authorized 2 years ago on an emergency basis. And it's taken us this long to try to help these folks come to the conclusion that we had come to was that this church since 1842 cannot continue to exist. The emotional issues we're dealing with here are really strong. First, we had to deal with them to get the cemetery divided off the church property because the cemeteries in this state are perpetual. And we wanted to make sure that that cemetery would continue to exist. The name will continue to be the Spring Place Cemetery. That won't change. We had to deal something with regard to the church property, because this property is sitting on the other side of railroad tracks on Love Creek Road in East Knox County, where there was no documented right-of-way giving access to the church property, which included the cemetery property. So we had to work through that. We had gotten that resolved. In the early 2000s, I chaired the committee that John, not church property. We had cemeteries we were responsible for. It ain't a problem. You find someone who's willing to take care of, who do you call when you want to have someone buried? Who do you call when you want to have someone cut the grass? And there's not many other responsibilities you have with regard to a cemetery. So I understand your questions about whether we have something in place to take care of it. And we have something we hope will work. But even if it doesn't work, we have no choice. This cemetery is going to be property of the presbytery. That's what the Book of Order provides for. When this property dies, all the property of a church becomes property of the presbytery. So it's nice to talk about saying no with regard to whether or not you want to approve this. This is an academic proposition. This is an You are correct. I apologize. I'm speaking to the moderator. I'm speaking moderator, but ultimately I think you all are going to hear it. But you're right. I'm speaking to the moderator. So we hope that this will work. We believe it will work. We have something in place which we believe will work. If it doesn't work, it still doesn't matter. This cemetery is going to be part of the presbytery.
Other questions, discussion? Anybody on Zoom with a question? All right, are we ready to vote? So we are going to take these motions together because one is just kind of the follow-up of celebrating the life of this church. So so all in favor of the motion to grant Spring Place Presbyterian Church of Knoxville authority to convey its cemetery property to the presbytery with the monies designated by the church as cemetery funds, also be transferred to the presbytery when the deed from the church to the presbytery is signed, and to celebrate the church's life after they dissolve on December 31st. If we have the poll ready to go for folks.
Just combining them, 1 second.
Okay, the motions are being combined for the poll on Zoom. We're ready? Okay, we're ready to vote. All those in favor of the motion say yes. All those opposed to the motion say no. Right, you all have our voting online as well. We will have our results in just a moment.
On Zoom, 31 yes, 0 no.
All right, the motion passes. Thank you, John. Anything else from property and loan?
I have nothing more.
Thank you. What? Yes, we did. I don't know. Would you like to register your vote now? All right. I know it is 12:10. We still have a lot of business in front of us. I don't know where Candace just went. I was going to ask on the status of lunch. Are you all good to continue a bit longer and see how much business we can get through? Okay. I am sensing that as well. All right. Nominating committee reports. Line of heart.
This one, so we don't have to move it up and down. Madam Moderator, I'm Lina Robinson Hart, a minister of Presbytery at Rivermont. With grateful heart, and with especially for all those very faithful ones of you that are willing to serve on our various Presbytery committees and commissions, and those who are currently serving I want to move the following names that are listed. I'm not going to read all of them and what they are going to be serving, but thank you for all of those who bringing your gifts and skills to the work of the Presbytery. Madam Moderator.
We have our slate of nominations. Any questions or discussion before we vote?
And I pray and trust that all the names are correctly spelled and designations are correct as well. LP means lay person, which now we no longer need to only have elders serving. Yay. So LP is for elders as well as non-elders, okay. Lay persons.
Thank you. All right, we are ready to vote. So all in favor of the slate of nominees, do you have the poll ready? Okay, we're ready to vote. So all in favor say yes.
Yes.
Any opposed, no? Vote online on the poll likewise. Motion passes. Thank you, nominations.
Favor,
thank
you. Zero opposed.
Yeah. All right. Andy and or Mary, I don't know how y'all are deciding to present this. What?
Madam Moderator, I'm speaking on behalf of the Congregational Relations and Development Committee, which I would refer our body to read an abridged history of our fine federation in the first paragraph. I only am standing before you to draw attention to the second paragraph, which indicates that this committee will be stewarding a grant from the Synod of the Living Waters that will be addressing technological needs throughout our presbytery. We've been doing this on a rolling basis so far. We've been stewarding this grant, but we'll be launching a mechanism to get the information and grant parameters out to the wider presbytery at the beginning of 2023. We'll also be entertaining appointments for technological consults if your church needs somebody to come and address technological needs. If you don't know what your problem is and how technology might be a solution to that, we will come and meet with you to determine that need. So any other information, you can ask questions.
Great. Thank you. Emily.
James McTyre, do you know the approximate amount of that grant from the Synod?
From the Synod, $26,000 over a three-year period. The only stipulation is that we have to report back joyfully about what we have done.
Okay. Yes.
Loudon.
So it says technology.
It's broad.
Yes. We've had discussions about how to receive and approve grants. We're leaning towards grants that are one-time or capital in nature, not necessarily operational expenses, but the committee will entertain all requests, including website development. So we're really seeking to address the needs of our smaller churches, but we will, this will be a Presbytery-wide grant opportunity.
Okay, great. So be on the lookout for that in early 2023. Thank you, Combined Congregational Relations and Development Committee. Trisha Dillon Thomas is gonna come up to speak for EQIP, or at least begin.
Basically just going to highlight what's in your packet already, but one good point of news is that Maryville College is happy to welcome Jamie Webster as their interim campus minister, so yay for that. UKIRK, UTK, and Hope House at UTC are coming towards the end of the fall semester. We covet your prayers as this is a time of high emotions, both for graduating and discerning jobs and also exams. So we certainly appreciate your prayers and fruit. Bring it by. it will soon be Giving Tuesday, which is a day of global giving. If you will, if you're interested in giving to that, this is a big fundraiser for both UKIRK at UT and at Hope House. So there's ways to give. If you follow us on social media, we would certainly appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you, Trisha. Is anybody else speaking from EQIP? Yes, thank you. I knew somebody else was.
I'm supposed to announce Loudon is supposed to go next.
Oh.
I will take over for Loudon. He has appointed me to speak. I'm Jessica Lewis. I'm the MAST program director at Maribel College. And so I wanted to report on some of our youth events. We had a successful middle school retreat where we had 80 people attend, and that was in September. We've also had some wonderful small and mighty youth group. It's a collaborative youth group event. And we've had over 50 youth attend our October event from 10 different churches. So that's the largest event we have had for Small and Mighty and the most churches we've had participate. Upcoming events, we are having our Small and Mighty Friendsgiving this coming Sunday at Farragut Pres, who is hosting us. And also in December, we are having a Christmas parade watching party. First Pres Knoxville is hosting us. Our youth summit dates are February 17th through the 20th. That is President's Day weekend. We've added a day so that our youth can have some more time together in fun and fellowship and faith. And we also, Expanding Horizons is coming up. It's a program held at Maribel College. It'll be June 25th through July 1st, and that is for high school students. And we will be looking at Shalom and how it also corresponds with the Native American Harmony Way, since we are on Native American land. So that's us.
Thank you so much. Anything else from EQUIP? That covered it. All right, Committee on Ministry, Sharon Young, you are up. And Wendy Neff. There we go. It's a trick microphone.
Moderator Sharon Young's First Presbyterian Church, Oak Ridge. Committee on Ministry report begins on page 10 in the meeting packet. We have a number of items for information, three items for action. First item, that the minimum terms of call for ministers of the word and sacrament in the Presbytery of East Tennessee be adjusted to reflect a 5% increase for 2023. You'll find those recommended figures in Appendix B, beginning on page 16. Moderator, on behalf of the committee, I so move and would like to speak to the motion.
Okay, thank you. So we have the motion and you can begin speaking to it first.
So the minimum terms of call have remained the same for the last 2 years. So it's time to make an adjustment. This proposed increase is below that of cost of living increase for next year, which is 8.7%.
Okay, thank you. Any discussion on the motion? Anyone on Zoom? Okay, are we ready to vote on the motion? Do we have the poll ready for this one? All right, all in favor of the motion say yes.
Yes.
Any opposed, no. Votes coming in on Zoom.
On Zoom, 29 yes, 1 no.
Okay, the motion is approved. Ready for your second motion.
Next item follows from the first, that the 2023 salary guidelines for directors of Christian education be adjusted to reflect a 5% increase in the base salary. That's Appendix C on page 18. Unfortunately, the form on that page does not reflect the updated figure for next year, which would move from the current $43,271 to $45,435.
45435. Thank you. Any discussion on the motion? If there's, you can come up and ask a question up here.
Not anything on Zoom.
Okay.
Is this also a 2 year?
The motion is for next year, and it hasn't been changed for 2 years.
Right. Any other questions or discussion? All right, are we ready to put the poll up to vote? All in favor voting online or here say yes.
Yes.
Any opposed, vote no.
On on Zoom, 29 in favor, zero against.
All right, motion is approved. Ready for motion number three.
Final item for action. The committee moves that all currently commissioned lay pastors, plus any others who successfully completed COP training and are duly registered and active in the Presbytery of East Tennessee, may supply a pulpit and preside at the sacrament of the Lord's Supper when invited by the moderator in the session of a congregation. And I'd like to speak to that. The current guidelines allow COPs to preside at communion within the context of their particular commission. This action would allow them to preside at the table when they're supplying a pulpit beyond that particular context, so that our smallest congregations in the presbytery don't have to wait to receive communion until a minister of the word, of word and sacrament is available to preside.
Very good. Thank you. Any discussion or questions on the motion? Any on Zoom?
No.
All right, I think we're ready to vote. Do you have the poll ready? All in favor of the motion, say yes. Yeah. Any opposed, no.
On Zoom, 29 yes, zero no.
The motion is approved.
Moderator, the final portion of our report is an update on the work we've been doing to revamp and rejuvenate our Presbytery CLP program. Had a task force hard at work over the last 6 months or so. Members of that task force are Emily Anderson, Lina Hart, Brenda Hooper, Wendy Neff, Paul Rader, Lynn Shockley, Ed Umbach, and myself. It's a group that includes CLPs, those who've taught in the program, and others. We're excited about the progress we're making in evaluating our current program and comparing what we have to other programs and other presbyteries and creating an outline of courses and instructors and so forth. I'd like Wendy Neff, a member of that task force, to say more, including a special opportunity that's coming up in January.
Thanks. Thank you. As our group gathered to work and talk about the commissioned lay pastor program, we determined its value to our presbytery and to the church at large, and are working hard to ensure that that program is viable, that it continues to help support the ministry of the church at large, but particularly the ministry of small churches in our presbytery. And so we are excited about that work that we are doing and look forward to sharing more with you as we move along in our work together. And in our conversations, we also talked about the importance of the people in our churches to study scripture together and that need to study scripture with one another. Within our presbytery, we have done things to serve together, and we value the importance of also studying together. And to that end, then, we have developed this Bible study that will begin presbytery-wide in January. Hopefully some of you have heard about that. I will lead us in a study on the book of Genesis, particularly looking at the ways that God calls us and we respond to God's call, and then what that means for our work in the world around us. They're passing out some sheets to you right now about this study and how we're going to conduct that. It's going to be a hybrid study together. So I will rotate among these five churches that are listed. It's a 5-week study. I will rotate among those. Our hope is that each of them will remain as a place where people can gather together to study, even when I'm not there. And so you are welcome to join one of these sites. If your church has the capability of doing Zoom and you want to gather in your own congregation, you're welcome to do that. If you want to gather from your couch or your kitchen table, we welcome you to do that as well on Zoom. But we hope that you will join with us as we study together this book in of Genesis, particularly looking through stories that are familiar to us of the ways God has called us and how Abraham and Sarah and Hagar responded to that call, how Joseph and his brothers and his family responded to that call, and what that has meant for us and means for us in these days. So I hope you will join us for this. There's no particular book that you need to read or study guide. In fact, most of us have read through Genesis or know the stories in some point. And so I hope you'll just come with an open mind and a heart willing to learn anew what God may be saying to us in this day through these words of the book of Genesis. Yeah, so no real curriculum. I have, in preparing this study, I have read the interpretation series Walter Brueggemann has done on the book of Genesis. Walter Brueggemann's Old Testament theology has been a part of that. A lot of stuff that some of us who have been in seminary have read, but then newer things as well related to that. And some things that are not even theologically written, but are just novels or books of understanding. And so there's no curriculum per se. I will give you that first week. I will give you a syllabus of sorts just so that you know what we're going to be doing together each of those weeks, but no curriculum.
Great. Thank you.
So one of the things the task force has landed on, I think, is a requirement for COP courses for there to be a minimum of 5 people for the course to take place. So if you all yourselves are interested, or you know of folks in your congregation who are interested, just express an interest. You don't have to sign up for it right now, but you'll find a basket and index cards and a pen for you to put your name and in legible writing to let us know how best to be in touch with you. That concludes my report.
Thank you so much. All right, is Bruce Wilson here or on Zoom for the personnel report? He's not here. So Bruce Wilson from the Personnel Committee. He's not on Zoom either. So is anybody else from Personnel here or on Zoom to present that report? All right, then we will hold off on that motion until we find out if that needs to happen right now. All right, Katina Sharp is joining us on Zoom, but I think she said Matthew Benz Whittington is going to speak first from the SERV committee. Sure.
Good morning or afternoon, everybody. My name is Matthew Benz Whittington, and I'm the pastor at Highland Presbyterian Church in Maryville, Tennessee. And along with Meredith Loftus, the associate pastor at First Pres Knoxville, we are the co-chairs for the Racial Justice Task Force of the Presbytery. This task force was formed several years ago in response to the family separation practices that were taking place at the U.S.-Mexico border, to the horror of many people. This initially became the Immigration Task Force, and as this group was formed and met monthly, they recognized the need to expand their scope and focus, and so became the Racial Justice Task Force. Over the past few years, we have met monthly to share, reflect, and discern how we can best serve the presbytery. That discernment led us to begin a racial bias and anti-racism training with a professional coach through Next Church Network. Those taking part in this training are ruling elder Glenna Raymer from Rivermont Pres, ruling elder John MacArthur from Fairfield Glade Community Church, Reverend Laura Becker from Northminster, Reverend John Gosten from Shiloh Pres, Reverend Lynn Shockley from Northside, Reverend Loudon Young from New Providence, Reverend Rachel Penmore from Ukirk Knoxville, and Meredith and myself. Our training is facilitated by the Reverend Leanne Hodges from National Capital Presbytery. In this training, we have worked to become leaders with an awareness of our own complicity with white supremacy and expand our tools to embody anti-racist leadership. We have asked ourselves hard questions. We have challenged ourselves every month to do better, and we strive to bring God's beloved community to life. As we near the end of our training, we hope to be a resource for all of you. We are not professional coaches ourselves, but through our experience, we hope that we can join you in conversation as you discern where your church, ministry, and community needs to go next. We hope to point you to helpful resources. We hope to get you started as you broach the conversation of racial justice and equity in your context. We know these conversations can be awkward, and unfortunately, many churches feel that it is not necessary.
The headlines we have all seen from the past few years tell us otherwise. And as we have become a Matthew 25 Presbytery, we must look at all three of those challenges and think critically about each one. But in this moment, I do challenge us to dismantle structural racism. And if this sounds like something your church does not need to worry about, let me tell you a short story very quickly. I recently interviewed a young biracial woman for a position at our church. As our conversation went along, it was going well. It was obvious that she was smart, talented, and full of enthusiasm and would be a wonderful fit. As our conversation neared the end, I asked her if she had any questions, and she said, "Yes, I have one. Will I, as a half-Black woman, be safe at your church?" In the year 2022, that is still a question that needs to be asked. And that is still a question that every single one of us needs to ask about our context. Is this place a safe space for all people? I come before you today that we need to ask that question about our churches, about our classrooms, about our pastoral care, and about our leadership. I come before you today to invite you into the conversation of racial bias and anti-racism that all of our churches need. And I hope that all of our ministry can be a place where all of God's children are welcomed. If the Racial Justice Task Force can help you in any way in that process, we would be more than happy to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Matthew. I'll invite Ann Brunger to have a brief announcement from the Peacemaking Committee and then Katina on Zoom to offer an announcement.
Thank you, Madam Moderator, for the opportunity to clarify something for the Presbytery. My name is Ann Owens Brunger. I am a minister member of this Presbytery, honorably retired. But I'm not retired from the Peacemaking Committee, and I've been asked by the Peacemaking Committee to explain to everybody, especially church treasurers, something that's become very confusing. So are there any church treasurers here today? Oh, good. Wonderful. Well, the rest of you then have the responsibility to communicate this to your church treasurers. Every year, Presbyterian congregations are challenged to donate to four special offerings. Our concern is the October offering received on World Communion Sunday, the peacemaking and global witness offering. Now, what's supposed to happen is that the church receives the offering, keeps 1/4 of what's given for their own peacemaking project, their congregation's peacemaking project. Then send the other 3/4 of the offering to the Presbytery treasurer. Then 1/4 of that, or then 1/3, the other fourth is kept for the peacemaking committee of our Presbytery for our projects. And then half is sent to the denomination offices for the denomination's peacemaking program. What we found is that treasurers don't know what to do with this offering. Some are sending it directly to the denomination's treasury and it disappears. So our Presbytery Peacemaking Committee doesn't get the 1/4 that we're supposed to get. We also don't even know that your congregation has been participating in this offering, so that we don't know the dimensions of the peacemaking ministry of our own presbytery. So please, you know, the formula is, the offering's received, 1/4 is kept for the congregation's own project, the rest is sent to Presbytery, Presbytery credits then a fourth, which is a third of what they get, to the peacemaking committee's ministries, and then the rest is sent to the denomination peacemaking committee. Right. Is that clear? Can you please communicate this to your church treasurers? Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. All right, Katina is joining us on Zoom and has an announcement as well.
Yes, thank you. Katina Sharp, teaching elder, Powell Presbyterian Church.
We are not quite hearing you.
Not hearing me. Can you hear me? How about now?
Okay, I think.
How about now?
You can go.
Okay, how about now? Okay, I am Katina Sharp, teaching elder, Powell Presbyterian Church, and the chair of the Serve Committee for the Presbytery. As Laura mentioned in her sermon this morning, we did commit to being a Matthew 25 Presbytery last year. And as you heard Matthew speak, one of the endeavors that we took on was the Racial Justice Task Force training that they did. And we have looked at how we can begin to look at some of the other areas of the Matthew 25 initiative in the coming year. And the Serve Committee is excited to ask you to participate in our RIP Medical Debt Project. You can see that in your Presbytery packet, how to get to that website. But we will be giving our group funds to this RIP Medical Debt program. Every $100 that we send them eliminates $10,000 in medical debt for families who need it most. Over half of Americans struggle to pay their medical debts, and in minorities, that number is more like 6 in 10. So this is hugely crippling for many of our neighbors. We have set a goal, because it's our Matthew 25 initiative, of $25,000 to be raised in the Presbytery in 2023. That would eliminate $2.5 million in medical debt for our brothers, sisters, siblings in Christ who need it the most. You can go online and donate as a church or as individuals, and that address is in your packet, and we'll also get it so that it can be on the church website as well. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Anything else from Serve?
That is it. Thank you.
That concludes Serve's report, from what I knew. And I have word that we have Bruce Wilson back to offer the Personnel Committee report. Bruce, we've got
and
you.
And my profound apologies for being gone. I'm on travel, and I had not was not able to get a substitute to cover for personnel. So, again, my apologies to the community for not being online at the start. Personnel Committee has been working on some issues related to personnel manual. The main thing that we have going forward is the motion for a pay raise for staff. After some discussion, we went with a proposal of 5% across the board for the direct Presbytery staff, which would be Jacqueline, James, and Josh. So, questions, comments, discussion?
Question. Anybody on Zoom with any questions or discussion? All right, I think we are ready to vote. So, do you have the poll ready, Jacqueline? Okay, all in favor of the motion, please say yes. Any opposed, no. I'm going to let folks come in on Zoom. Okay, motion is approved. Thank you, Bruce, for jumping in on the Zoom to be able to offer that.
Yep,
anything else?
Thank you, folks.
Personnel.
No, thank you. That covers it.
No. Okay. Thank you so much. All right. Bree is going to offer the outdoor ministry team report on Roy's behalf.
Yes, my name is Bree, and I serve as the executive director for the John Knox Center. I normally do not speak on behalf of OMT, but the OMT moderator is out sick, and with short notice, our vice moderator couldn't come to Chattanooga and be on Zoom at this particular time. And so you get the third string speaker. And I realized this morning that I believe that if you take out the Presbytery meeting that was hosted by John Knox Center in August of 2021, This is the first in-person Presbytery meeting that John Knox Center staff have been able to attend since February of 2019. So it is wonderful to see you all. Yay. We are glad to be here. Now, obviously, part of that was COVID and nobody met in person. But part of it, too, has been that on the weekends or the weekdays, namely May, that the Presbytery has met, we have been inundated with guest groups and school groups. And so that is a good problem to have. So as enjoyable it is to be here with you today, the reason we have not been here in the past partially is because people have been at John Knox, and that's a good thing. You can read the highlights of 2020 as far as programmatically in the packet. We hosted more campers this year than we have in 14 years, which is very exciting. But oftentimes OMT will ask me, well, what is your capacity? Capacity does not have anything to do with the number of beds we have. It has to do with the number of supervising staff that we have. So while we are excited that 2022 was awesome, I will tell you that we have been approached by a nonprofit to work with us to send underprivileged children to camp. And currently, with our staffing situation, we cannot host them. They want to bring 75 kids for a week during the summer on top of our own summer camp and send these kids to a faith-based camp. These are kids from East Tennessee. We have told them that we cannot do that in 2023 simply because we do not believe that we can hire that many staff. So I tell you that to implore you to go back to your congregations. Speak to anyone who has anyone that is a college age person, anyone 18 or over, that would be willing to be a counselor this summer for us. And now that's not just a job. It is also a ministry. We very much feel like it is a ministry to our young people, our college students, our young adults. But I ask you, we want our staff to come from the Presbytery of East Tennessee. We very much give them priority when they apply. Please ask the folks in your congregation, your grandchildren, your nieces, your nephews. We want good Christian kids who are hopefully grown up in the Presbytery PCUSA to be counselors for us. So that is my first request from you today. I do want to give a shout out to Sequoia Hills, to Rivermont, and to First Pres Knoxville. They were our top sending Presbytery churches this year of kids coming to summer camp. All three of them scholarshiped many of their own children from their congregation to come to camp. And we very much thank them for their support in that. As we go into 2023, we are excited about a couple of things. One, the guys that are doing the dining hall floor just got to camp. I just saw them on the ring camera. It's so exciting. So you might not have noticed the floors before in the dining hall or can't remember them. They're atrocious. They have been painted about 75 times since 1960. And there was not a place the size of a postage stamp that had not had a chip or a scratch or something on them. And so we are currently in the process of polishing concrete in the dining hall. So hopefully as you come and stay in 2023, you will see brand new floors in the dining hall. And we're also excited about our sewing retreat that happens in January and February. If you have quilters, and I know many of you do have quilters, please send them to our website to check out our quilting and sewing retreat in 2023. We are also in conversation with the Purdue rowing team to bring 125 college athletes to camp during March, during their spring break. We haven't quite figured out where we're going to store all the food it takes to feed 125 college athletes, but we're going to try. And they're planning to come in March, so hopefully that contract will go through, as well as we are working with the Korean Church of Knoxville to plan an Easter retreat for their congregation over Easter. So that's exciting as well. I do want to address one thing that Emily talked about when we were discussing salary and all of that. She mentioned the financial transparency of John Knox Center. Typically, in most every other Presbytery report, except for this one, the treasurer has provided a report that is the Presbytery finance, which also includes John Knox Center. So you get to see everything from how much we income in different areas of our program to the expense for everything from postage to the gas that it takes to mow the grass, all the way down to that. The reason it was not provided in this particular Presbytery meeting report is because the deadline for the packet didn't really coincide with September 30th. The Presbytery treasurer had not done the expense report. We also had not received all of the Presbytery payments from churches for our summer camp program. So it really kind of skewed the report itself. But 99% of the time, if you look at the Presbytery report, you will see the entire budget expense and income for John Knox Center at every Presbytery meeting. And if you just are curious in between, contact Josh McGill. He is the Presbytery treasurer, and he is happy to provide that for you. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Bree. All right, James, what do you have for your report for us today? You want to come up here, or are you good there?
My report's written on pages 13 and 14, I think, on the packet. I wanted to add one thing is that in my work on Sundays, I have an incredible gift, a luxury of being able to go around to different churches throughout this presbytery. And in the coming year, I'm going to be working harder on getting up earlier and coming to Chattanooga. But it's amazing to see the different ways churches do worship, the different personalities that you have. But I tell you, almost without exception, when I visit our smallest of our small churches, and we have a lot of them, more than two-thirds of our churches are under 100 members, almost always the churches will say, in some form or another, we're sorry, we're not bigger. And my response is never, ever apologize for your church's size. Jesus only had 12, and look how well that turned out. I don't know how many of you watch Abbott Elementary. Anybody watch Abbott Elementary? Yes. Best show on television. If you're a teacher or have kids, please watch that show. It's an education in itself. There's one episode where the teachers are putting together their need list. And what they found out is that if you create a TikTok video that's really fun, you'll get a whole flood of glue sticks coming into the room. And there's one teacher whom everybody loves, who's the kindergarten teacher, and she's been there for 30 years, and she does things her way, and she hates technology. Well, the other teachers get together, and they surprise her with a TikTok video asking for supplies, and she gets flooded with supplies, and she is incensed. And she says, is it nice to have stuff? Sure. But my students do not need to feel less than because they do not have stuff. Your churches never need to feel less than because you do not have the stuff that other churches do. Now, to you churches that are large, that have great music programs and wonderful programs of outreach and ministry, great. I am so pleased to be able to worship with you and enjoy that. But I'm also very, very pleased to be able to go to the smaller churches with their DIY attitude of just getting stuff done. And that is truly the best part of what I get to do.
Thank you, James. All right, we are in the home stretch, my friends. Don't have any unfinished business or new business. Oh, Emily. Okay.
I'd like to talk about the John Knox budget again.
No,
I'm kidding.
I know.
this is a request, and it should have come up during the coordinating committee report. I see that we are virtual only in February. That's typically the time that we vote on amendments to the Constitution. We have 33 of them this year, and they're not little bitty things. They are significant issues. I'd like to, at least through our general presbyter, send the word to the coordinating committee that we might delay those until May, the May meeting when we're together.
I appreciate the feedback. Thank you. And Carl just walked out of the room. He's the next. He and PK are next on the agenda. Let's take a quick stretch break. You'll just stand up for a second. All we have to do is install our moderator and vice moderator, which I'm happy to do in a moment. But Carl just left the room. So just, yes. Okay. Just a quick announcement, Kathy. While y'all quietly stretch, we'll listen to this announcement.
Hey everyone, Kathy Meyer, Second Presbyterian Church here in Chattanooga. Thank you all for coming today. Sometimes I speak when I should be silent, and sometimes I'm silent when I should speak. And I should have spoken today with the Committee on Preparation for Ministry and their Clinical Pastoral Education Change in Language. I am married to a clinical pastoral education supervisor, and I know that there are CPE associations that charge a lot and that require a lot of hoop jumping that make it difficult for especially seminarian students, but others to accomplish the CPE unit requirement. My husband has used a lot of imagination in his supervising to provide CPE that is affordable. He allows the interns to make payments, to do whatever they need to do. Some of their business places, workplaces will offer to help pay for that. He has a hybrid offering of CPE so that interns can do it online as well as in person. He has created associate relationships with workplaces all over so that they do not have to be in person in Dalton at Hamilton Medical Center, where he is the chaplain, so that they can be where they are and not have to travel. He has done a lot of creative figuring to make CPE work. So I would like to propose to Susan and the Committee on Preparation for Ministry, as well as all of you, to please feel free to be in touch with me. I will be glad to give you the name of Reverend Ken Waddell, who is also a Presbyterian pastor and chaplain. Some folks are trying to provide clinical pastoral education, which is a life-transforming education. If you ask any who have done CPE, they will likely tell you it's the best thing that they did in seminary. I'll be glad to talk with you and give you his name and information so that you can be in touch with at least one supervisor who's trying to make CPE accessible to as many as possible. Thank you.
Thanks, Kathy.
I'd be a traitor.
All right, Carl is heading back in. PK, go ahead and you're invited to come on and join me up here. Carl, if you'll come join up here, we are ready to install our Presbytery moderator and vice moderator for the new year. If you will turn to Appendix G, that is where we have our liturgy that we will use for this. So y'all can come on up here. Join me on the chancel up here. And so you all will do the bold parts and I will lead the others. Y'all come on up. That's fine, fine. All right, welcome friends. So let us begin this joyful opportunity to install our moderator and vice moderator. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. Lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called,
making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as we were called to the one hope of our calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. We are called by God to be the Church of Jesus Christ, a sign in the world today of what God intends for all humankind. The great ends of the church are the proclamation of the gospel for the salvation of humankind, the shelter, nurture, and spiritual fellowship of the children of God, the maintenance of divine worship, the preservation of the truth, the promotion of social righteousness, and the exhibition of the kingdom of heaven to the world. The call of Christ is to willing, dedicated discipleship. Our discipleship is a manifestation of the new life we enter through baptism. Discipleship is both a gift and a commitment, an offering and a responsibility. Carl, you have been called by the Presbytery of East Tennessee to serve as our moderator for the coming year. Ilson, PK, you have been called by the Presbytery of East Tennessee to serve as our vice moderator for the coming year. Carl and Ilson, the grace bestowed on you in baptism is sufficient for your calling, because it is God's grace. By God's grace, we are saved and enabled to grow in the faith and to commit our lives in ways which serve Christ. God has called you to particular service. So I invite you to show your purpose by answering these questions. Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love?
I will love myself.
Do you welcome the responsibility of this service because you are determined to follow the Lord Jesus, to love neighbors, and to work for the reconciling of the world?
I do.
Will you serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love, relying on God's mercy and rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit? Do you, the members of the Presbytery of East Tennessee, confirm the call of God to our brothers Carl and Ilson as moderator and vice moderator of in the service of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Will you support and encourage them in their ministry? Let us pray. Faithful God, in baptism, you claimed us, and by your Holy Spirit, you are working in our lives, empowering us to live a life worthy of our calling. We thank you for leading Carl and Ilson to this time and this place. Establish them in your truth and guide them by your Holy Spirit, that in your service they may grow in faith, hope, and love, and be faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Carl and PK, you are installed to the service of moderator and vice moderator in the Presbytery of East Tennessee. Whatever you do in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through him. And may the God of peace make you holy in every way and keep your whole being, spirit, soul, and body, free from every fault at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you very much. Thank you. You need
to stay
here.
Okay.
Last year, this group elected the Reverend Laura Becker to lead this presbytery as its moderator, and it was a good choice. There are certain traits and experiences that a good moderator should have, and Laura has them. Intelligence, grace, cooperation with others, leadership traits such as caring, focusing, flexibility, calmness, accessibility, creativity, adaptability, good communication skills. Kind of makes you wonder why I'm standing up here this morning, doesn't it? Anyway, Laura is thoughtful, willing to listen, willing to make decisions, good with people, and comfortable with herself. She took us last year through a very difficult period. What with COVID, Zoom, hybrid meetings, and all that those interruptions involved. And here we are a year later, and we are still here doing the same work we did before, all of what the past year has both given and taken away. And we thank Laura for all that she gave us that brought us here today. Laura, we have a small token for you of our gratitude, small but sincere, which there's with our thanks for your leadership and care of the presbytery. We know that you're not going away, that you will still be here to give us all of your gifts, including your experience as moderator. And we thank you in advance for that, for which we should fail to thank you for later. Thank you for your leadership for the churches and the members of this presbytery. I believe I would now entertain a motion that we adjourn with prayer. And I hear a second. May we pray. Father, we praise you for the gift of unity that the Spirit creates in our relationships. You place others perfectly in our lives and inspire us as Presbyterians to work together with the gifts that we have been blessed with. When we look at this meeting through your eyes, we see your gifts fostered in us to future plans. Forgive us, Father, for the control and credit that we grasp for these meetings while planning and accomplishing projects together. We confess that honoring you through our work is not always at the forefront of our minds as we strive for end goals. In the spaces of our hearts that harbor envy and ambition, we prayerfully ask you to make room for humility and shared credit. The church doesn't stand on any one person's shoulders. Not one of us can further your plans of our own, but together we can complement each other's strengths and cancel out our weaknesses. As a team, a unified body focused on the gospel of Christ, we can do great things in your honor as we were purposed to do. Thank you for the ideas that you spoke life into here today and for the courage of each voice that stood to be heard. In each one of us lies a puzzle piece. One by one, as we stand and speak and work, we see our individual pieces moving into place. We continue to strive for your will, piece by piece. Now with that, we ask for safe travels home so that we may return here again somewhere to do your work. We ask all this by and through your Son and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We are adjourned.